Good morning. After discussing about single error correcting Hamming codes in the last class, let us talk about another method of decoding and detecting and correcting for errors in linear block codes, which involves the use of standard array, also known as the lookup table. So the outcomes of today's class are, at the end of this class, you will be able to write a standard array or lookup table and enter all the 2 power n code vectors of a code into the table. You will also be able to detect and correct all error patterns in the received vector incorporated into the array. All the error patterns which we have incorporated into the array, all those patterns, if they occur in the received vector, you will be able to detect and correct them. You will also be able to realize the error detection and correction circuits in hardware for the standard array. And in the end, you will also be able to write a general decoding circuit for any n, k linear block code. Moving on to standard array or lookup table, the decoding strategy which we are going to discuss is based on a very important property of the syndrome. Say, suppose vj is a code vector, we could also call it as cj. And this subscript j varies in powers of 2. This is 2 power 0, 2 power 1 till 2 power k, because we have k bits in the data or message, right? Our message vector or data vector is k bits in size. So we have totally 2 power k distinct code vectors in an n, k linear block code. Correspondingly, for any error pattern E which occurs in such codes, all the 2 power k distinct error vectors EJ can be defined as follows. So the error vector EJ can be written as E modulo 2 added with the code vector VJ. VJ or CJ mean one and the same here. Here again, J varies in powers of 2. 1, 2, so on till 2 power k. Okay. The set of vectors EJ, which is so defined, is called as coset of the code. So what does this coset contain? This coset contains exactly 2 power k elements, which differ at most by a code vector. So there is a difference of just one code vector between adjacent elements in a coset. It also follows that there are 2 power n minus k cosets for an n, k linear block code. So we will have 2 power n minus k rows in a linear block code. And after multiplying, let's multiply equation 1 with H transpose. We know that in order to detect and correct errors, our parity check transpose matrix is needed. So when I multiply both sides of equation 1 with H transpose, you'll be getting EJ into H transpose is E into H transpose XOR with VJ into H transpose. We know that the correct code vector multiplied with H transpose is always 0. We have already proved this result. So eliminating this term, we know EJ into H transpose will be equivalent to E into H transpose. So what's the meaning of this statement? This statement shows us that the right hand side of the equation is completely independent of the index J. So in this equation 2, the RHS is completely independent of this index, irrespective of whether the index is 1, 2, 4, 8, whatever. It will be independent because for any code word, the term CJ into H transpose is 0. We know that. So from equation 2, it's clear that all error patterns which differ at most by a code word will have the same error syndrome. And this character of having a unique syndrome for all elements in a coset is what is going to be used in constructing a standard array.
So let's look at what is the procedure to construct this standard array. Since this received vector r may be any of the possible 2 power n tuples, remember there will be n bits in the received vector. So I can have any of 2 power n combinations in the received vector. So irrespective of what the transmitted code vector was, there are 2 power n possible combinations to be formed. And we can, by using equation 1, we can partition the received code bit into 2 power k disjoint sets. So there is no link between one row and the next. Each one is disjoint. That's why we say 2 power k disjoint sets. And using that, we will try to identify the received vector. So this job is done by constructing the standard array or the lookup table. And the steps to construct this standard array are as follows. You can observe. First step, you have to place the 2 power k correct code vectors of the code in the topmost row. Okay. And the all zero code vector is the first or leftmost element in the topmost row. So what does the topmost row consist? It consists of all the correct code vectors in the code. So there will be, if I have a k bit message, I will have 2 power k correct code vectors for a code. All those correct code vectors, we place it in the topmost row. That is first step. And we always begin with the all zero code. Next, in step two, I know that with n bit code word, I can have 2 to the power of n different possible combinations. But out of 2 power n, only 2 power k combinations are right because I have a k bit message. So what will happen to the remaining 2 power n minus 2 power k? So of the remaining 2 power n minus 2 power k code vectors or n tuples, I'll call them as n tuples because n bits will be there in each vector. E2 is chosen, that is one error pattern. E2 represents an error pattern. An error pattern E2 is chosen and it is placed below the all zero vector. So when we choose E2, please remember, whenever we choose E2, we will always choose starting from the lowest weight, an error pattern of lowest weight, Hamming weight of the error pattern we are talking of. We'll start choosing error patterns of lowest weights and we'll place it below the all zero vector. Remember, all zero vector is a correct code vector. Below that and everything in that row, the first row, are correct code vectors. I'll have 2 power k correct code vectors in the first row. Now to construct the second row, what we are doing, below the all zero code vector, we are introducing an error pattern having the least Hamming weight. So if all zero is the correct code vector, the next least Hamming weight vector will be Hamming weight of 1. So I will introduce an error in one bit position, say leftmost bit position 1 followed with all zeros, something like that. An error vector will be written below the all zero code vector. And the remaining elements in the second row will now be formed by adding this error pattern E2 with the correct code vector which is present in the topmost row. So every correct code vector in each column will be added to this error pattern. And that's how we will construct the second row in the standard array. Okay. Similarly, to construct the third row, I have to take another unused error pattern of less Hamming weight and place it below the all zero code vector column. Place it in the all zero code vector column below the second one, whatever we had done. The third one should also be an error pattern of low Hamming weight. So when I exhaust all error patterns of weight 1 and still the table is not complete, then I will start using error patterns of weight 2, that is two ones in your pattern. Okay, we will see that in the examples which we are going to discuss how to do it. So again, you complete third row as we did in step 2. You add the topmost row columns with this error pattern and you'll be able to complete the third row. Now continue this process until the complete table is done. So until all the possible 2 power n code vectors have to be included, till then you're going to continue filling up this lookup table or the array. Yeah, you can see it in this example. Your C1 is the all zero code vector, which we are writing as the top leftmost element in the topmost row. Next, all valid code vectors C2, C3 till which point? C2 power k. Remember, if I have a k bit message, for k bit message, you will have 2 power k valid code words or code vectors. Okay. So it will range, if I use them as subscripts, it will range from C1, C2 till C2 power k. All these in the topmost row are the valid code vectors. Please remember this. Now, how to construct the second row in the standard array? I have to define an error pattern E2 having lowest Hamming weight, and to construct the remaining elements, I'll place this error pattern below the all zero code vector. As I was telling you, if the topmost element is all zero, the element having lowest Hamming weight after zero is one single bit as high. So you introduce error in one bit and you write that error pattern. Now, how will I get all the elements in the second row? You take this topmost row correct code vector, add it to the error pattern, you will get one code word with some error. Similarly, C3 plus E2 will give you another code word with error. So on C2 power k plus E2. Likewise, the third row will be computed by defining another error pattern of lowest Hamming weight. And see, this should be different from this. One thing you should remember, as you're filling in this E2, E3, EJ, so on, it should not resemble any of the entries in the upper rows. Every time I define an error pattern, I have to define an entry which is not present in any of the upper rows. Only then it will be something new error pattern and all new entries will be present in the final filled up code vectors in that particular row. Okay, so likewise we'll go on filling the jth row and finally the n minus kth row, e2 power n minus k, will be again c2 plus e2 power n minus k, c3 plus e2 power n minus k, so on, c2 power k plus c2 power n minus k. So remember, all these additions are modulo 2 additions. Okay, now we have constructed our standard array like this, and from the discussions which we have done till now, it is clear that there are 2 power n minus k disjoint rows or cosets. As I was telling you, each row is called a coset. Okay, and all rows totally put together, I'm going to have how many? 2 power n minus k, starting with C1 is equal to 0. I'll have 2 power n minus k different or disjoint cosets. Okay, we call them disjoint because they are not related to each other. The rows are completely independent of each other. Okay, and the first n tuple or the first entry of that is the entry in the first column, this one, the entry in the first column is known as the coset leader. Okay, all these entries, the error patterns which we are entering in the first columns are called as coset leaders. Every row is one single coset, and the first column entry for each row is the leader of that coset, and it is called coset leader. This coset leader, remember, defines an error pattern which holds good for the complete row. That means this will define the error position by which every element in that row is going to be affected. Which bit in all these words is affected, that is defined by this coset leader. Okay. Now, coming to some important properties of the standard array. Standard array consists of 2^n code vectors, which are partitioned into 2^k disjoint cosets as shown. So naturally, with an n bit code word, I can have 2^n different code vectors or different combinations. All that should be present and entered in the standard array. And out of that 2^n, only 2^k are going to be valid code vectors because my message size is k bits. Okay. And the first entry of each row is known as the coset leader, and it represents a correctable error pattern for all the codes that are present in that particular row. As I was telling you just now, E2 represents a correctable error pattern for every element which is there in row 2. Similarly, E3 represents the error pattern for all elements in row 3. Likewise, it has. So the coset leader is generally the correctable error pattern for all elements in that particular row. Now, each element in the array is distinct. Therefore, different columns in the array are said to be disjoint. So every element is disjoint or not linked to one another. And generally, the adjacent elements of a row will differ at most by a single code vector. We know that. What is the difference between the adjoint elements in a row? See, this is C2 plus E2, this is C3 plus E3. So whatever is the difference between C2 and C3, one code vector, the same difference is there between C2 plus E2 and C3 plus E2. Similarly, these elements will define by one code. Every adjacent elements in the standard array will differ at most by a single code vector. Remember these properties. Then, since the error pattern of smallest weights are chosen as coset leader, the type of decoding which results from this kind of standard array is called minimum distance decoding. Why? We are using minimum distance between the adjacent elements in the array, and the error patterns which we use are generally of the lowest Hamming weight. So whatever type of decoding results from this kind of entry is called minimum distance decoding, and the other name for this is maximum likelihood decoding or majority logic decoding. Please remember, the most commonly used name is minimum distance because we choose error patterns of lowest weights. Maximum likelihood, meaning to say whatever detection and correction of error happens, there will be maximum likelihood to get the correct results. You'll be doing proper decoding, say most of the time. Or majority logic decoding is another name given because based on the logic applied in decoding. Okay, we'll be seeing shortly how we are going to decode. And all the 2^k code vectors in a single row will have same syndrome and error pattern. We have already discussed one row will have same syndrome and same error pattern. Now, let's try to see how we are going to decode the received vector using a standard array and how we are going to detect and correct the errors. We generally talk of two methods for decoding and detection and correction of errors. The first method is as shown. You compare the received vector with each and every element or entry in the table. Okay, so it will surely match with one of the entries. But remember, only the topmost row are the correct code vectors. So if you identify the element in some other row other than topmost row, that would always be a received code vector with some error. So how would you say which is the correct code vector for that particular element? You just have to move to the topmost column in that, the topmost row in that column. The topmost row always consists of the correct code vector. See, you observe the entries here. All entries in this have the code vector as CI. And what is the correct code vector? It is CI. Here we are adding errors to the particular code vectors and getting CI plus E2. So, for example, if my received vector matches with this entry, I can automatically say the corrected code vector would be the topmost entry in this particular column, which is CI. Similarly, say my received vector matches with this entry, I'll say the correct code vector would be the topmost element of that particular column, that is C2. That is method one of identifying errors. And you'll also you're also correcting by just taking the topmost entry. Now, in method two, what are we going to do? We are going to multiply the received vector with the H transpose matrix. So you take the received vector and multiply it with H. That's the normal way we used to do in linear block codes, right? So you just take that received vector and multiply with the H transpose matrix and you obtain the syndrome, okay? By finding the, once you get the syndrome, you know, you have to match it with the rows of the H transpose, or you can match it with the first column entries in the standard table. Okay, usually we are going to specify the first column as the syndrome column. Okay, so you match it to the syndrome from the table, and from corresponding to every syndrome, I'm going to have an error pattern. So you just take that error pattern corresponding to that particular syndrome and add it to the received vector, you'll get the corrected code vector. What I mean to say is, to the left here, beyond this column, I'm going to have the syndrome bits in another column. Say this is syndrome S1. Here I'm going to have syndrome S2, S3, so on. So I'm going to have syndrome bits as the entry in the leftmost column. Now what will I do? I'll take any received vector. Say I receive this vector. I'll take that vector and I'll multiply it with the H transpose matrix. I'm going to get the syndrome vector Sj. So you're going to get this particular syndrome vector. Now what you do? You just take out the corresponding error pattern to this syndrome. So I know the error pattern corresponding to this syndrome is Ej. All what I have to do is, I have to take the received vector Rj, add it to this error pattern Ej to get the corrected code vector, what? Cj or whatever. Whatever it is, the corresponding code vector, which will be obtained by simply adding the received vector to the error pattern which is defined here. So that is another way of doing different ways of talking about this also. You can observe that every coset is characterized by unique syndrome, and there's a one-to-one correspondence between coset leader, which will always represent a correctable error pattern, and the syndrome, just what I was telling you now. These relationships can be used in preparing a decoding table, which is made up of 2 power n minus k coset leaders and their corresponding syndromes. So I'm going to add the syndrome vectors in this table. The error patterns are already there. Okay. Now, this table is either stored or wired into the receiver. So what are the steps that can be used for decoding? Compute the syndrome. This was method 2, what I was telling. Compute the syndrome as received vector into H transpose and locate the coset leader EJ whose syndrome is S. Remember, I'll have syndrome in this row. Then I will have the coset leader starting with what? C1, which is all zero value. And from below C1, I'll start with E2, the error pattern E2, which has Hamming weight as 1. Similarly, error pattern E3, so on we have. Now, corresponding to each syndrome, I can identify the error patterns. So you just locate corresponding to the given syndrome, what is the error pattern E? And as I told you, decode the received vector by adding R to E. This is known as syndrome decoding or table lookup decoding. And remember, this is applicable only for any linear N, K code, and it need not be a systematic code. Any linear code, it works. Even if the bits are mixed up, it still works because every row will have a correctable error pattern. And if I get the value of that error pattern and I add it to the received vector, I'll be able to correct the code vector. Okay. So let's take an example of a 6,3 linear block code and see how it looks. I have just taken an example to show you the entries. See, in the leftmost column, we are going to write the syndrome bits, okay, or the syndrome vectors for each row. The next column represents the coset leaders. The coset leader at the topmost row corresponds to the all zero code vector, which is a correct code vector. Then if you observe, I have chosen what? Error patterns with lowest Hamming weights. You see in the second row, I have taken Hamming weight as 1, the least significant bit in error, then the second least significant bit, 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th. The most significant bit is in error. And once we complete all this, please observe, this is a 6,3 code. So how many entries I should have in the table? I should have 2 power 6, which corresponds to 64 entries in the lookup table. LUT, we can call it in short. So we should have at least 64 entries in this lookup table, which means how many rows here we had? 7 rows. I have 7 rows and 8 columns in each row. You see, we have only 7/8, 56 entries. So I need one more last row to complete this table. Now comes the difficulty, because if for this error pattern, you have to choose an error pattern which hasn't been present in any of the 7 rows. Either that is one way of doing it, or the other way of doing it is, you know all these syndromes which are distinct. So with 3-bit patterns, you can guess what is the syndrome which hasn't been used. So the syndrome which hasn't been used, you just take that syndrome and multiply it with any of the correct code vectors. So, or in other words, the syndrome will be R into H transpose, right? So I'll just assume a received vector and multiply it, or you take any of the correct code vectors. Here you're going to have what? This is C1, C2, the correct code vectors which are there. If you take the correct code vector and multiply it with H transpose, you will get the value of, you'll be able to obtain the value of the syndrome or the error pattern. To find this error pattern, it's best if you search through all the rows and get one condition of two ones. Remember, after exhausting all single ones, I have finished six rows of single ones where Hamming weight is one. Now I should go for Hamming weight of two. The next lowest Hamming weight is two. So I'm trying to find an entry, an error pattern, which is not there in any of the above seven rows. And once you find that, you can compute the rest of the code bits by simply adding the correct code bits in the top row to this error pattern. So it will introduce error in those two bit positions, say the last and the fourth bit position. Two bit positions will be in error in the last entry. So this is what happens in a 6,3 block code. Let's take an example and solve this. Okay. So construct the standard array for a 6,3 linear block code. Given the parity matrix, I have a 3x3 parity matrix. It is k cross n minus k. So n minus k is 6 minus 3. Detect and correct errors for the received vectors R1 given as 100, 100, and R2 four zeros and two ones. Draw the error correction circuit for the same. Okay. So we know that if I have k as 3, since k is equal to 3, I will have 2 to the power of 3 code vectors, right? Which is 8 code vectors. Now I can compute the correct code vectors which should go into the topmost row entry by computing C is equal to D into G. Remember, all this is matrix multiplication. Okay. First, I should write what is the generator matrix. It can be written in the form of identity matrix appended to the parity. The parity is given. So you just have to list a 3x3 identity matrix, or I3 we call it as. To that you append the parity matrix which is given. Now we have completed our G. Now what should you do to find all code vectors? You should start considering all possible values of D, the data vector. With 3-bit combination, this ranges from 000001 to 111. Each combination you can take and multiply it with the generator, you'll be getting the correct code vector. That's one option. Or as I have shown you in the earlier classes, you just take this as a, in the standard form, D1, D2, D3, and multiply it with the generator matrix and list the equations. See, the code bit C1 should be equal to D1, C2, D2, C3, D3. C4 will be this column into this row. So it is D1 plus D3, as you can see. Okay, wherever there are ones, those particular data bits are included. Then C5 is equal to D2 plus D3. C6 is D1 plus D2 plus D3. So if I get this, it becomes easy for me to determine all the code vectors. You see, based on this, I have here the first three. The first three bits are same as data. So if I have D1, D2, D3, here C1 is D1, C2, D2, C3, D3. This bit, we got it as what? D1 plus D3. So this bit corresponds to D1 plus D3. This corresponds to C5 corresponds to D2 plus D3. So C5 corresponds to D2 plus D3. And this corresponds to D1 plus D2 plus D3. Now, given the values of D1, D2, D3, using these linear equations, you can compute all the code words for the given code as shown. So all the code words we have computed for this code. Now let us construct the standard array. So always we'll start the construction of standard array by writing down the syndrome values in the leftmost column. What will I consider as the syndrome values? The syndrome values would be corresponding to here. We have the parity matrix, right? Syndrome values would be nothing but your H transpose matrix. So to get the syndrome values, your syndromes can be obtained from H transpose or R into H transpose. How do I get the H transpose? It is parity matrix appended with identity matrix. That's all we are doing here. I've taken, first I should take the all zero syndrome representing what? Syndrome of no error, zero error. And after that, I will just repeat the parity matrix 101, 011, 111. You can see 101, 011, 111. Now, I have to consider what is left out of these syndromes in the H transpose matrix. I should have the identity matrix 100, 010, 001. Now I have exhausted the complete H transpose matrix or all the syndromes. Now what should we do? I still need one row entry to be completed. I told you why just now. Because I need to have 2 to the power of 6 or 64 entries in the standard table of lookup array. So what are we trying to do? I have to find a pattern here of two errors. Till here, the error pattern was one in the leftmost bit, one in the next second bit to the left, one in the third bit to the left, so on. So all these are 6 single error patterns which we have exhausted, and the topmost is the zero error pattern. Now, the next pattern which I choose to have lowest Hamming weight after 1 is 2. So I have to choose a pattern having 2 ones, and that pattern should not be present anywhere in this previous rows. So if you look at the complete entry until this row, we shouldn't have this pattern. So such a pattern you should identify and fill it up, and you take this error pattern and multiply it. So whatever is the error pattern I'm getting, 1 1 followed with all zeros, I'll multiply it with the H transpose. I'm going to get the syndrome vector as 110. So the error pattern into H transpose generates the syndrome vector, which is used in the last row. Okay. Now, while filling up the last row, we know how to fill each row. You have to add this error pattern with the correct code vector. So whichever position is a change, that position change will be observed here. See, if you notice the second row entries, all the first bit position have been changed from what was there in the topmost row because it's an error in the first bit. Similarly, if you notice the third row, the error will be in the second bit. So all second bit positions would have been changed in the entries. Likewise, we can go on doing it. Okay. So this is about constructing the standard array. Now, before going to how to draw the decoder circuit, I told you if a received vector is given, you can just multiply the received vector with H transpose matrix. So the H transpose matrix has the parity matrix and identity matrix. What are we doing? I am multiplying the received vector with this. So it's a 6-bit received vector R1 to R6. And when I multiply it with H transpose, depending on the value of R, I will get a syndrome. Okay. So let's say 100100 into this H transpose 101 011 111 100 010 001. Okay. So I'm going to get, I have 1 in the first bit position and the 4. Here, 1 in the first bit position as well as 4th bit position. So 1 or 1 is present, 3rd bit positions are 0. Okay, 1 or 1 is 0 because it's binary or modulo 2 addition. What is next? This row into second column. When I go for the second column, the first bit is a 0 here and the 4th bit is also a 0. So it will result in 0 plus 0, which is a 0. And last column, the first bit, I'm just looking for matching bits. I told you that's how we can multiply, right? So 1 into 1 would be 1 plus, check for the 4th bit position here. The 4th bit position is a 0. So 1 plus 0 is a 0. So what am I getting the syndrome as? 0, 0, 1. I'm going to get the syndrome as 0, 0, 1. Now, what should you do? You just go to the table. You check where you have 0, 0, 1. Okay. You have 0, 0, 1 in last but one row. That is the 7th row. And notice what is the error pattern corresponding to this row. Bring that error pattern and add it to the received vector. So this received vector plus the error pattern in the 7th row, which will be what? Error in the last bit position. So 00001. If I add this, what would I get? The corrected code vector C1 cap will be wherever the error bit is there, that bit should change. 100101. So this would be the correct code vector. And going back to this table, I'm in the second method, what I can do, see, I'm searching for the entry 100100. That was the received vector. 100100 was the received vector. And if you observe, that entry is present in the 7th row and 5th column of the lookup table. Now, what should I do to get the correct value? I'll just look to the topmost entry here. And the topmost entry 100101 would be the corrected code vector, whatever we had to achieve for correction. Similarly, let us use that method for the second pattern. Search for 4 zeros followed by 2 ones. You see where you are getting those 4 zeros followed by 2 ones. Yeah. If you observe, I am getting this in third row, third column. So 4 zeros followed by 2 ones is obtained in the third row, third column. Now the topmost row entry there gives the corrected code vector for this. That means it is 010011. Okay. Means there will be a change in which bit position is this. Second bit position. The second bit position would have been an error. So what should you do? Here you say, comparing to standard array, this pattern this pattern is present in which row? Third row, third column, right? Third row, third column. Therefore, the corresponding error pattern E3 is 010000. Therefore, the corrected code vector C3 is E3 plus R2, which would correspond to 10000011. Oh, sorry, 10 is lesser here, 6-bit. Okay, so 0100. The 1 should be in the second bit position because according to the error pattern, it's a 1 in the second bit position. So this is our corrected code vector, and if you observe, it matches with the entry in the topmost row. 010011. Okay. So I hope it is clear on how to detect and correct errors in the standard array using either of the methods. Either directly search for the received vector in the table and consider the topmost row entry of the table as the corrected code vector, or you can multiply the received vector with the H transpose matrix, get the syndrome, and once you get the syndrome, the entry in the next column of the syndrome will be the error pattern. Take that error pattern and modulo 2, add it to the received vector, you'll get the corrected code vector. Okay, all this is done. Now, in order to draw the error correction circuit, if you remember, we had drawn this error correction circuit previously once. What should we do? I have to consider all the syndrome entries here. See, the leftmost row corresponds to the syndrome entries, and next to that, it is all correctable error pattern entries. So the error pattern entries play an important role in writing the hardware circuit for error correction. Now, corresponding to wherever you have a 1, 1 in the leftmost bit position is present in the second row and also in the last row. You can observe the last row also has a 1 in the first bit position. So what are the corresponding syndromes here? Corresponding to this, the syndrome will be S1, S2 bar, S3. Yes or no? So corresponding to this, this is each bit will be S1, S2, S3. If I have to design a combinational logic circuit, I always have to do what? For a combinational logic circuit, you just have to write the sum of products expression. So I have to define the product terms corresponding to ones in the entry. There is a 1 here, which means this entry should be present as a product term. It corresponds to S1, S2 bar, S3. And corresponding to the same column, there is a 1 in the 8th column, which means I have to OR it or add it with the corresponding syndrome in this particular row. And what is that? 110 means S1, S2, S3 bar. 110 corresponds to S1, S2, S3 bar. So this will give me the computation for error in the first bit position E1. Okay, I'm considering error in first bit position as E1, error in second bit position as E2, so on, error in sixth bit position as E6. Now coming to the second bit position entry, you observe there is a 1 in the third row. And what does this value correspond to? that corresponds to S1 bar, S2, S3, and there is a one in the last row also. Okay, there is a one in the last row, which means I have to consider the corresponding syndrome in this last row, which is a 110. 110 means S1, S2, S3 bar. Okay, so I will have the error bit E2 as the modulo 2 addition of two syndrome product terms due to two syndromes, right? Because there are two ones in the second bit position. Now coming to the one in the third bit position, it's present only once here, and the corresponding syndrome will be all ones. Sorry, S1, S2, S3, okay? And fourth bit position, 100. Fourth bit position is 100. S1, S2 bar, S3 bar. Fifth bit position is 010. So 010 means S1 bar, S2, S3 bar. And sixth bit position finally represents 001, S1 bar, S2 bar, S3. Okay. So now we have the sum of product expressions for all the error bits. And now our job is just to draw the error correction circuit, for which I should first draw the syndrome calculator circuit. Remember, in hardware, first step is to determine hardware. Okay, to find or determine hardware, step one is draw syndrome calculator circuit, syndrome calculation circuit. Next, step two, draw the combinational logic circuit, draw combinational logic circuit to determine bitwise errors. Okay. So for example, to draw the syndrome circuit for a 6,3 code, how do I calculate the syndrome? The syndrome is calculated as a 6-bit received vector, right, into the H transpose matrix. What was our H transpose matrix? 101, 011, 111, 101, 011, 111. Next is 100, 010, 001. So with this, I can get the linear equations for syndrome bits. Here, I'll have three syndrome bits, S1, S2, S3. Therefore, I can say S1 is equal to this received vector into first row. So wherever I have ones, those bits in the received vector should be included in the equation. So R1, R2 is 0, R3 into 1 plus R4 into 1. This gives me the syndrome vector S1. Similarly, S2 is R2, R3, R2, R3 plus R5. Right? This is the fifth bit position. And lastly, syndrome S3 will be R1 plus R2 plus R3 plus R6. So all these positions are to be considered whenever I'm multiplying this received row vector with every column of the H transpose. So now what should I do to implement the hardware? You can see it is done here. First, you take a shift register. So this is a shift register with 6 bits, R1 to R6. To this, the received vector should be entering serially. Serial entry of the received vector R1 to R6 happens at this position. Okay, as you can see, at this position it happens. Now, as we already have the equation, I'll first determine the syndrome bits by using these equations. R1, R2, R4 gives me syndrome S1. So you can see R1 is connected, R3 and R4 are connected. R1, R3, R4 should be connected to give me the syndrome bit S1. Similarly, for syndrome bit S2, it should be R2, R3 and R5. R2, R3 and R5 to compute syndrome bit S2. They are the entries. If you are confused, please write it. R2, R3, R5 are the entries. And to compute syndrome bit S3, I have 4 entries. R1, R2, R3, R6. Therefore, 4 entries will be there. And all those 4 inputs will be given to the modulo 2 adder. Now, I just have to get the syndrome bit S1 and its inverted version S1 bar by using NOT gates. And all I have to do is realize the sum of product linear expressions using AND OR gates. S1, S2 bar, S3 plus S1, S2, S3 bar. So 2 AND gates and 1 XOR gate for obtaining the correctable error bit E1. Take that correctable error bit E1, the error bit, and add it to the received bit to get the corrected code bit C1 bar or C1 cap. Just like this, we have written before. So I hope you understood how to write these equations and how to write the gate realization of each of these equations. Okay. So now, once I have the error bits, how will I get the corrected code bit? By adding this error bit to the corresponding received bit, E1 added to R1, I'm going to get C1 cap, the corrected code bit. Similarly, E2 added to R2 will give you the corrected code vector C2 cap. Likewise, we'll go on continuing. Okay. So this will complete the hardware. You can try another example at home. I'll just show you in brief how it is done. Here we have taken 7,4 block code and the parity matrix is given. So first you have to construct all the code vectors. How many code vectors will be there? Since k is 4, I will have 2 to the power of 4, which is 16 code vectors, right? And how do you find all the code vectors? G would be identity appended with parity. So I'll write an identity matrix of 4 rows and 4 columns. Remember, identity is always a square matrix, right? So we are writing the identity matrix and I'll just drop down this parity matrix. 101 110 011 111. Done. We are done with the generator matrix. Now, if I multiply this generator matrix with, each and every message vector, let me say D1, D2, D3, D4. The 4 bits in the data vector or the message vector have to be taken and multiplied with this generator matrix because C is equal to D into G. Okay. It would go to this mode. And as I told you, you can make a table and list all possible code vectors. So I haven't listed it here. You can just make a table and just like how we did before, syndrome, then the error pattern. And after that, all corrected code vectors, all zero syndrome, the error pattern would be all zeros. All seven bits are zeros now. Here the only change is having seven bits. Now I should write the valid code vectors I have to find by taking all possible 4-bit word combinations. Data word can be ranging from 0000, 0001, 0010, so on. It can continue till all ones. So I'm going to have totally 16 combinations, okay? And for each of the data words, we can use these linear relationships or the product and compute C1, C2, so on till C16, okay? And likewise, if I list the standard array, you see the syndrome entry is in the leftmost. It will include all elements of the H transpose matrix in the same order. And topmost row, which will have all zero code vector, will have all the correct code vectors computed using this technique. So each bit in the code word was computed. Just like that, all correct code words will be present in the top row. The next row, I'm going to choose an error pattern with a 1 in the leftmost bit position, low Hamming weight. So just 1 bit error, and you just have to toggle the leftmost bit in the first row entries to complete that row. Next error pattern is 1 in the second bit position. Accordingly, the second bit position of the upmost row entry changes. So this is how we are going to construct. Here, I'm completing all the syndromes only by the time I reach the eighth row. And here I have a unique error pattern because it's a 7-bit code word. There it was 6-bit. So I would finish all the 6-bit error patterns in 6 rows. And for 7th row, which was needed, we would have a problem. But here, the 7th row will already have a 1. All these entries are filled. All you can do is, you can just determine where there are errors and match it with the topmost entry. It will give you the correct code vector. Okay. So this completes standard array. With this, let's just wind up these linear block codes by discussing a general decoding circuit for an n, k linear block code. So, if we consider C as the transmitted code vector and R is the received code vector in a linear block code, then n minus k bit syndrome is computed as R into H transpose. We know that n minus k bit syndrome is computed as R into H transpose, where each of the bits can be considered as a different function of the data bits. Okay, so general decoding circuit can be drawn by considering this diagram. We've just shown a block diagram. What do we do in the decoder? We should have a received vector buffer or a shift register. The shift register, n-bit shift register, to store the received vector. Now, the n-bit received vector is passed on to a syndrome calculator circuit. You're going to get n minus k bit syndrome.
Once the n minus k bit syndrome is calculated using the syndrome calculator circuit, the input to which is the n bit received vector, we have to have a combinational logic circuit to enable detection and to enable correction of error. So we have to generate the error bits E1, E2, so on until EN, where E1 indicates error in bit 1 position, E2 is error in bit 2 position, so on. Now, this combinational logic circuit is something similar to this what we have discussed. The upper one, the shift register with the modulo 2 adders, represents the syndrome calculator. And the shift register we have already shown in this. So that is nothing but the received vector buffer register, which will have n bits, where the received n bits of the received vector will be stored. The syndrome calculator will basically have modulo 2 adders and multipliers or switches. And the error correction circuit would be a combinational logic circuit, which is built using AND OR gates. And finally, once we are able to get the error bits outside E1 to EN, all what we have to do to obtain the corrected code vector is to add the received bit to the corresponding error bit. So R1 is added to E1 to get the corrected code bit C1. Similarly, R2 is added to E2 to get the corrected code bit C2 cap. So on, we are calling the corrected code bits as C1 cap, C2 cap, so on. So we'll be able to correct all the code bits from C1 to CN using this modulo 2 addition of the error bit with the received bits. Hence, we'll be able to detect and correct for errors using this generalized circuit in any n, k linear block code. Hence, in this class, we have discussed how to construct a standard array or lookup table for an n, k linear block code. And we have also understood detection and correction of all error patterns in the received vectors for such error patterns which are inbuilt into the array. And we have also realized the error detection and correction circuits in hardware for the standard array. And in the end, we have discussed about a general decoding circuit for any n, k linear block code. So with this, we'll end today's class. In the next class, we'll discuss about another subcategory of linear block codes known as cyclic codes. Thank you.